family moved from Ireland to Pennsylvania, and her father worked in a coal mine. And when she was 21 years old, she struck out on her own and headed for Chicago, where there was an exposition. And there she set up a sandwich shop. And she did a good job with it because she saved quite a bit of money. And from there, she moved further west. She went all the way out to San Francisco. She set up an ice cream parlor. She was doing really well there until the ice cream parlor burned down. That was her first business adventure downward. But then she had a good attitude, so she looked around, found a job as a stewardess on the Pacific steamship line, and they plied the coast of North America all the way up to Juneau, Alaska. And she, when she saw Juneau, there was a, gold had already been discovered in Juneau in 1890 or even before that. And she went and worked in a clothing store in Juneau. And 1896, she happened to be in the right place at the right time, because that summer is when George Carmack found that nugget over across the range in the Yukon, in the Klondike. And so she was right there ready to go over the Chilkoot Pass. She was among the first ones over the pass after the discovery. And she didn't take what normal people would take, you know, food and clothing. And I mean, she had some of that, but she didn't take a lot of it. She took things she knew she could sell because she was a good businesswoman. She was described as very bright. She was prepossessing kind of a person. People were just attracted to her. And she was just an amazing businesswoman, entrepreneur. So she decided to take over the pass, things that most people wouldn't have. She took bolts and bolts of cotton cloth. She took hot water bottles. She took silk underwear, things like that. She spent $5,000 on these items, and she got to Dawson City and sold that for $30,000. Well, she took that money and she set up a sandwich shop in Dawson City so she could feed the miners. And she met an Englishman who had been down the Yukon River and lost everything in one of the rapids on the Yukon. But all he had left was a dog. It was a pup, pretty big pup. This dog was a St. Bernard mix, and he couldn't afford to feed the dog. So he went to Belinda and said, "Would you keep the dog for me?" And she said, "Sure, with one deal, and that is that at the end of the summer, the dog gets to decide who's going to go with you or me." And so at the end of the summer, of course, the dog chose Belinda, and so she had this dog and as a pup, and she decided to build a hotel right in the middle of the gold field. So she went up right where the Bonanza Creek and the El Dorado Creeks came together, and she built a hotel called the Grand Forks Hotel. It was a fancy hotel. It had brass beds, it had chandeliers, it had china. She also had a bar and a restaurant in the hotel. And to show you what kind of a good businesswoman she was, she had the help sweep the floor every night and then take the sweepings and run it through a sluice box. And they got an extra $100 a day just doing that. So a very bright woman. And so she had built this hotel. She was getting rich, richer and richer. Well, at the end of that, at the end of the next winter, it was turning springtime, and she needed to go to the bank in Dawson City to deposit some gold. And she did this trip quite often. In fact, she trained her dog Nero to take her on a sled the 18 miles from the hotel down to Dawson City to deposit the money. She made lots of trips back and forth. He was the only dog in the team, just a one dog team. And this spring, she had three pokes of gold she needed to take down, and it was, there wasn't enough snow to use the sled, so she decided to walk with Nero. So she took one poke of gold, put it in her backpack, took the other two and put it in a dog backpack on Nero, one on either side so it would balance the load. And then they headed down to Dawson, and they came to a stream. And the only way to get across the stream was on a log. And she made her way across okay, but Nero was not very good at walking logs, and he got out in the middle and fell into the stream, kerplunk. She was horrified. She ran downstream and intercepted him by climbing out on a thick willow branch. It hung down over the water. She was able to reach down and grab the dog's collar because the weight of the gold was taking the dog under. She was afraid the dog was going to drown. But there she was, stuck on a willow branch, hanging out over the creek, and didn't know what to do because she couldn't move backward or forward. And And then she saw some miners. They were coming across the log, and she yelled at them. She said, "Get over here and get your knife out. Jump in here and cut this backpack off this dog." She was willing to sacrifice 2 bags of gold for Nero. That's how much she liked this dog. Well, the miners weren't very good at listening, and they didn't see the dog's problem. They saw a damsel in distress. So they went running out of, and one man climbed out on them, that willow branch, but the weight of her and him plumped the thing down into the stream for splash. They were swimming around in the cold stream. She finally had a free hand. She pulled out her knife, cut the pack of gold off of the dog, and it sunk to the bottom, and she never found that gold again. That's how much she liked Nero. Well, she got some money. She made the money up in the Grand Hotel in the gold fields, and she decided that she needed to build a hotel, a bigger one, down in Dawson City. But before that, she decided, I need to take a vacation. I want to go back to Pennsylvania to visit my family. So she had built the hotel down in Dawson at this point, and she put Nero down in the basement and made arrangements for somebody to feed him while she was going to be gone for 2 or 3 months. She packed up her bags, went down, got on the riverboat pulled out, was heading downstream, and somebody said, "Here comes Nero!" Well, the dog came running down from the hotel, he busted free from his confinement, and he jumped in the water and started swimming after the riverboat, which was heading downstream. And when the miners saw that, they said, "Go, Nero, go, don't let her go." And the men on the boat saw the dog too, and they told the captain, "Shut the engine down, we gotta let this dog catch up with us because he wants to go with his mistress." And he did, and the dog got on, they pulled him onto the riverboat, and they said, "Well, this dog has earned a trip down the Yukon with his mistress," so they let him stay on the riverboat, and they headed on down to St. Michael, where they hooked up with steamships. Now, when they got down to St. Michael, she got on a boat called the City of Topeka. And it just so happened that she had worked several years before on that same steamship going up and down the coast of North America. And so here she was. She headed down there with Nero. They got to Seattle. She decided to take Nero to a Turkish bath and clean him all up. And so they did that, and then she checked into the Rainier Grand Hotel, best hotel in Seattle. She had chained Nero to, tied him to a gate down in the basement of the hotel. So she's going up the stairs to check into her room, and she heard this clang, clang, clang. Nero had pulled the gate loose from whatever it was attached to and was dragging it up the stairs. So she had to hide Nero in her room for that night. And then the next day, she was to catch a train to Pennsylvania. Well, she knows she couldn't take the dog on the trip. So she found a man who had a horse stable, and he agreed to keep Nero. And so he did, and she took off. And 2 or 3 months later, she finally came back to Seattle. She went to the stable, but the man said, "I'm sorry, ma'am, but your dog ran away several weeks ago, and I haven't seen hide nor hair of him since." And she was just devastated to have lost Nero. But she didn't give up. She started looking all over Seattle for this dog. And she looked and looked for 2 or 3 days, and finally down by the wharf she saw him. He was skinny, he was all dirty, malnutrition. He was even in a bad shape. So she took the dog and took him back to that Turkish bath, gave him another bath there, got him all cleaned up, started feeding him, and took him back up to Dawson. So she went back to Dawson, and now she settled into her business again, you know, running the hotel. And that next summer, she met a man who claimed that he was Count Carboneau. That's what he said his name was. Well, rumor had it, really, he was a barber from Quebec. He was a French-Canadian, and he was there as a champagne salesman. But they hit it off, and they got married. And then he convinced Belinda that she should go spend the winter in Europe and live in Paris, and she had enough money to do that. And so they did. They took off and they made a couple trips back and forth between Europe and the gold fields doing their business. But then she found out after a couple of years that she had been taken. This count had been embezzling her, and she lost almost all of her fortune. So instead of giving up, her true business-like nature came through, and she decided, well, there was gold discovered in Fairbanks. I'll just go up there and start a business. And she set up a bank called the Dome City Bank in 1904, 1905, and she became a wealthy woman again. And finally, she left the North Country, and she headed down to settle into more southerly climes. She went to Washington State, and in Yakima, she built a mansion and invited her sisters from Pennsylvania to come join her and live in that mansion. And but the money began to run out, and eventually she had no money left, and she ended up living in a rest home for the rest of her life in Seattle. And there was a man in 1962, Belinda was 90 years old at this time, and he went to interview her, and he was telling the people in the interview about what an amazing woman she was and how much money she'd made in the Yukon and all these great things that she'd done. But she was a very modest person, really, and she was dismissing all this and all saying it's nothing. And she was keeping a stiff upper lip about the whole thing and very composed until he asked her about Nero. And when he brought up the name Nero, little tears began to come down her cheek, and she began to think about that dog that she had left behind. And I tried to find out exactly what happened to Nero in all of my investigation on this story, but I couldn't. So you can just kind of picture whatever you think might have happened to Nero. But remember Belinda Mulrooney, the richest woman in the Klondike. Thank you.